اوكي بدنا نبدا الجلسه التاليه اللي هي عمليا جلسه مكمله للجلسه السابقه. عنوان الجلسه هي العوده الان، نماذج عينيه رقم 2. في عنا ثلاث متحدثين في هذا المجال. نعمي أشقر من قرية إقرث، ودكتور أوري ديفيس، ودكتور سيلما بوبوريتش. راح نعرف عليهم بعد قليل. المتحدث الأول راح يكون الأستاذ نعمي أشقر، اللي هو مهجر من قرية إقرث، رئيس جمعية أهالي إقرث، تربى ككل الأقارثة على حق، على الوعي بأن لهم حق مسلوب ويجب إعادته لأصحابه. يناضل منذ الصغر لتحقيق العودة إلى بلده على كل المستويات. يعمل في مجال الأنظمة المحاسبة والهايتك. رح يحدثنا عن نضال أهالي إقرث للعودة إلى بلدهم تحت عنوان القوة الجماهيرية. أستاذ نعمي تفضل. نعم، محاضرة بالعربي.
مساء الخير. أنا المضبوط متواجد هون لأنه الأخت شادية مركزة الجمعية ما قدرت تيجي لأسباب طارئة، وفاة في العيلة.
احكي بالميكروفون قريب، ارفعوا لي ان شاء الله ريمة الميكروفون يتر. اود
اوكي. از بالبلطه دي أنا المزبوط بدي أحكي، فيش عندي عرض ولا في شرائح. بدي أحكي عن تجربتنا في جمعية أهالي إقرت في نضالنا من أجل العودة، عن تجربتنا المميزة والنضال الفعلي اللي هو على أرض الواقع. مش راح أحكي كتير عن ألام النكبة، عن التشرد، عن اللجوء. بدي أستغل الفرصة وأعمل نوع من السجال بيني وبين الحضور، كيف إحنا منمارس تجربتنا لتحقيق العودة. فلمحة تاريخية عن موضوع إقرت. إحنا تهجرنا بشهر 11 سنة 48، عملياً 6 أشهر بعد قيام الدولة. التهجير تم بمرحلتين. المرحلة الأولى أخذوا كل النساء والأطفال والشباب، والمرحلة الثانية اللي كان بقي فيها الزلام 3 أشهر بعد التهجير الأول، نقلوا اللي تبقى في القرية لقرية الرامي. فالتهجير القصري اللي كان هو كان عمليا التراجيديا والمأساة اللي بديها أهالي إقرت. احنا من هذاك اليوم ومن ناضل من أجل العودة. الشيء المميز كان في موضوعنا كقرية اللي تهجرت لحوالي 25 كيلومتر، أهلينا يعني نقلوهن لحوالي 25 كيلومتر بعاد عن إقرت في ظروف لجوء، كان إنه إحنا بعد فترة طلبنا نرجع. ليش طلبنا نرجع؟ لأنه كان واحد من الشروط التهجير تبعتنا أو من الاتفاقيات اللي كانت بيناتنا إنه إحنا منغيب بس لجمعتين لسبب انه في اعمال عسكرية في المنطقة وبدوا يحافظوا على سلامتنا. بتفكير فطري جدا انكتب اتفاقية صغيرة هيك مع قائد القوة اللي احتلت البلد، وبعد ما فهمنا انه احنا اتهجرنا ومش راح نقدر نرجع لانه كان في حكم عسكري ومنعوا مننا الرجوع لبلدنا بعد الاسبوعين، بعد 4 أشهر من التهجير توجهنا لمحكمة العدل العليا وربحنا المحكمة. المحكمة هو عمليا القرار الوحيد اللي احنا طلعناه بحقنا من التهجير لحد اليوم. باقي القرارات كانت تطلع مش بحقنا او بعملية مراوغة مع الزمن. للأسف الشديد بعد ما طلع قرار العودة من محكمة العدل العليا ب 30/7/51 الحكومة أو الجيش هدم البلد في 24/12 ليلة عيد الميلاد، هدم البلد على كل البيوت ما عدا الكنيسة والمقبرة. ومن هذاك اليوم احنا عمليا من ناضل من أجل إعادة بناء إقرت من جديد. النضال تبعنا كان في فترة الحكم العسكري مقتصر على مقابلات مع السلطة و المناضلين من اليسار الإسرائيلي. بهذيك الأيام حتى ما كان في تميز بين اليسار واليمين لحد سنوات 70 اللي فيها قاد النضال تبع أهالي إقرت المطران يوسف ريا، اللي من خلال هذا النضال كانت أكبر مظاهرة بتاريخ الدولة بشهر 8 في القدس، 5000 شخص تظاهروا قدام مكتب رئيس الحكومة. بعدين كان بشهر 10 اعتصام وأضراب عن الطعام اللي فيه قابلنا أو المطران ريا قابل جولدا مائير كانت رئيس الحكومة. ومن هذاك التاريخ كان في عملية مؤسسة لبناء نضال أو تنظيم لنضال اللي يستمر. أهم شغلة في نضالنا كانت من خلال هاي السنين هي عملية التثقيف في البيت والتربية. إحنا تربينا كل أهل بلدنا، تربينا على إنه في عنا حق مسلوب ولازم نرجعه. هاي الشغلة بتراودنا كرعية من يوم التهجير. احنا عمليا بنمارس إقرثيتنا وعودتنا بشكل عملي. احنا من صلواتنا في البلد، للأسف كمان احنا بنقبر موتانا في البلد في إقرت، وهذا هو المحل الوحيد اللي بناخد فيه حق في الرجوع موقع من السلطات. لما انت ميت بتاخد حقك انك تنت في نغاد. بفترة الثمانينات كان عندنا فترة حافلة في النضالات مع اليسار، خاصة اليسار اليهودي. في آخر الثمانينات وبداية التسعينات كمان صار حتى يعني في مؤيدين لقضيتنا من اليمين، من الأحزاب اليمين في السلطة. الموضوع تبعنا وصل للقمة في سنة 95 لما لجنة وزارية، أنا عم بحكي باختصار، ممكن تتوجهوا للويب سايت تبعنا وتشوفوا كل إشي، بس لأنه في وقت محدد بعد باختصار بعدين أفوت على المداخلة. الموضوع تبعنا زي ما قلت أخذ مسار نوع من الشرعية، إنه عنا لجنة وزارية، عنا قرار بمحكمة العدل العليا إنه إحنا نرجع، عنا تأييد جماهيري. إحنا ببلدنا منمارس طقوسنا، ما حدا بيعترضنا، مع إنه في كتير مشاكل بالسنين الأخيرة مع سلطة الأراضي. وأهم شيء هو زي ما قلت الأمور اللي إحنا يعني بنعتبرها رأس مال اجتماعي لإلنا، يعني السوشيال كابيتال تبعنا هو إنه كل أهالي بلدنا بيشاركوا بكل قضايا وبكل المناسبات في البلد. احنا منعيد في في بلدنا من نتزوج غاد من عمد غاد بلدنا كلها مسيحية فكل الـ الـ النشاطات الجماهيرية بتتم حول الكنيسة لأنه كمان هي المبنى الوحيد فزي ما قلت اللجنة الوزارية هي كانت نقطة مهمة في كيف نكمل نضالنا احنا نستمد من هذا نضالنا على المسار القانوني لأنه احنا بنشتغل على عدة مسارات منا السياسي منا الاجتماعي الجماهيري ومنا كمان القانوني فبالمسار القانوني لما احنا بنحكي على انه في عندنا قرار محكمي وفي عندنا لجنة وزارية فهذا بيعطينا قوة ف خلال في الواقع يعني كانت في فترة لما كان رابين بالحكم اللي كان فيها تقريبا وصلنا لاتفاق يعني كان في خطة للعودة أخذنا الخريطة وين الأراضي كانت عملية تعويض في معادلة لعملية التعويض اللي فيها شعرنا إنه كان في إشي ملموس يعني فهاي الشغلة بتميز موضوع قضيتنا عن باقي القضايا إنه إحنا في صار عنا إشي في الواقع وملموس أكتر من الآخرين فللأسف لما إجا شارون على الحكم رفض إنه يكمل في المشروع وهيك انتهت القضية لحد آخر 4 سنين اللي فيها احنا قررنا انه نمارس العودة بشكل فعلي مجموعة من الشباب قبل 3 سنين ونص 4 سنين طلعت وسكنت في القرية في عنا احنا بنينا قطين حد الكنيسة القطين دول مع مطبخ بنيناهن هبطوهن بنيناهن هبطوهن 3 مرات وبعدين اسه في عنا مجموعة من حوالي بين 14 ل 25 شخص اللي بتناوبوا على التواجد في البلد يعني عمليا البلد عايشة ومفتوحة توجناها قبل 4 أشهر في إنجاز كبير هو إيصال كهرباء للكنيسة عمليا هي إيصال كهرباء لإقريت لأنه إحنا عم نحكي على قرية مهجرة اللي ما فيها ولا أي مبنى غير مبنى الكنيسة وأبعد نقطة عن البلد هي موجودة في بلد تاني مستوطنة تاني بعيدة بس هذا كان نضال قضائي اللي أخذ معنا 11 سنة عمليا احنا من 11 سنة طلبنا كهرباء وما وفقوا توصلنا محكمة مركزية وبعدين محكمة العدل العليا 3 قضاء أقروا إيصال الكهرباء لإلنا بس العملية ما انتهت في القرار المضبوط يعني الممارسة في تنفيذ القرار علمتنا درس كبير لأنه تأخذ قرار في محكمة العدل العليا بقولش إشي حتى قرار في الحكومة بقولش إشي القضية هي قضية التنفيذ فمنذ 4 أشهر إحنا عندنا كمان كهرباء في الكنيسة وهذا دلالة كبيرة على صدق أو مصداقية قضيتنا وعلى الأمل في العودة الفعلية من خلال السرد هذا ممكن انه تفهمون انه احنا يعني في عندنا تميز معين اللي بلخصه ب4-5 نقاط اللي هي انه في بلدنا احنا فيش ولا اي مستوطنة على ارض بلدنا يعني 24,000 دونم ما فيش عليهم ولا اي مستوطنة وهذا بقول انه ما في حق شرعي لأي حكومة أو قوة إنها تبني على أرضنا لأنه إحنا متواجدين غاد كمان الإشي الثاني إنه عندنا قرار محكمة العدل العليا الثالث عندنا توصيات من لجنة وزارية اللي عمليا كل توصيات اللجان الوزارية هي بتكون في مستوى قرارات حكومة طبعا بس في موضوعنا ما كانتش هيك فالإشي الأقوى من الثلاث أشياء هدول هو التعاضد تبع الرعية تبعتنا إحنا أهل بلدنا عنا زي نظام سيستم اللي بيشتغل كيف إنه الولد لما يخلق يعيش يمارس إقريثيته على أرض بلده، خاصة في المخيم الصيفي اللي فيه إحنا من 21 سنة بنعمل مخيم صيفي بالصيف أسبوع كامل، بنبني الخيم عشرات ومئات الخيم مرات بتكون بالبلد، وبنقعد أسبوع أسبوع نضالي تثقيفي توعي، أسبوع اللي فيه بنعمل منمارس الإقريثية تبعتنا من جيل لجيل، منعرف الأطفال والشباب على البلد، على معالم البلد، على البيوت، على الشوارع، على التاريخ، على القصص، على الأحداث. فهاي شغلة مهمة اللي احنا يعني بنعتز فيها وبتميزنا عن كتير من القرى المهجرة الأخرى. الاشي التالي الرابع اللي احنا يعني بنشوفه انه بقوي علاقتنا في الارض هو عمليا الممارسة تبعت طقوسنا. احنا بنعيد في البلد، يعني لما في عنا الكريسماس احنا بنطلع البلد، لما احنا عنا اسا عيد الربيع عيد الفصح بنروح بنعيد في إقرت. يعني عمليا احنا ساكنين في قرى او لاجئين في قرى بالشمال، اغلب اهل بلدنا بالشمال تقريبا بحيفا كفر ياسيف والرامي، ومن بأي مناسبة احنا بنلتقي فوق ان كان بفرح او بكره. فهذه هي الاسباب اللي احنا بنشوفها كتميز في 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 نضالنا وفي الاستمرارية تبعت نضالنا. في كم شغلة اللي مهم انه نذكرن، التنظيم تبعنا، التنظيم مهم جدا، بناء خطة العمل تبعتنا مهم جدا، انه احنا نشتغل بدون تردد على كل المستويات. وهذا الاشي احنا بنلمسه اليوم لما تقريبا احنا كل ثلاث اسابيع مرات اسبوعين كنا بنروح على الكنيسة. يعني احنا عملنا لوبي بالدورة السابقة في الكنيسة اللي كان رئيسه عضو كنيسة من حزب صهيوني موشي مزراحي، اللي كان واحد من الأعضاء البارزين في حزب العمل، وما كان عندنا مشكلة انه نلتقي مع أعضاء كنيسة من اليمين، يعني من تساحي هنقبي لعوفر شيلح عمرا ميتسنا. طبعا انا بديش احكي عن العرب، اعضاء كنيسة العرب وعن اعضاء كنيسة ميرتس، مع هيرتسوغ التقينا، مع جيلا جامليئيل، مع كل اعضاء الكنيسة اللي عمليا احنا منحضر الارضية لبناء لوبي اللي يدعمنا لما توصل للنقطة. يعني شو اللي توصل للنقطة؟ انه احنا بطريقنا بالآخر يعني من آمن أنه بهاي الفترة بهاي المرحلة الزمنية نضالنا هو لازم يعني يتركز على المستوى الحكومي. إحنا بعدنا ما وصلنا القوة اللي تقدر تزيح المحتل من أرضنا ونيجي محله، إحنا بعدنا موجودين في واقع معين اللي عم نمارس نضالنا من خلال هذا الواقع، طبعا بدون ما نرفع ايدينا، بدون ما احنا نستسلم ولا باي مرحلة من المراحل. الشغلات اللي انا بسبب ضيق الوقت يعني بدي اذكرها هو انه احنا بعملنا المميز كنا دائما مبادرين لشغلات، مثلا قضية الكهرباء هاي، انه احنا نتوجه لانه ناخذ كهرباء، انه اسا عندنا توجه انه نطوب المقبرة، عندنا اسا توجه في يعني في البروسيس انه احنا ناخذ طابو على ارض المقبره، وهذا الاشي راح يتم. الاحداث هاي الصغيره بدها بالاخر تجيب العوده. باخر اربع سنين قمنا بخطوه اللي هي اكثر عمليه، بنينا ماستر بلان للعوده، على اساس لما نحن نقعد مع مؤسسات انه احنا نيجي مع دارسين موضوع ومبني على اسس. فأخذنا بروفيسور بالأوربان بلانينج وعملنا ماستر بلان، اللي حاولنا كمان إنه من خلال هاي الماستر بلان نتعاون مع مؤسسات في 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 الداخل هون. عنا كان نشاط مع لجنة المهاجرين, كان عنا نشاط مع لجنة حقوق الإنسان حول هذا الإشي. للأسف هذا النشاط ما انتهاش كيف لازم ينتهي. احنا كنا عاملين كدراسة يعني اللي فيها نعرض مشروعنا ونأخذ عنه انطباعات إذا كانت سلبية أو إيجابية, وين أخطأنا. إحنا ما منخاف من إنه إحنا أخطأنا أو إذا في كان غلط إنه نصلحه. المشكلة كانت إنه مع هاي المؤسسات ما قدرناش نتعاون للأسف الشديد. هن بيشتغلوا كيف بدوا, الصندوق السويسري يعني شو الأجندة تبعت الصندوق هن بدهن يشتغلوا. احنا طبعا احنا بنشوف حالنا حرين. احنا بنشوف انه حتى موضوعنا يعني كمهجرين كقرية اللي عندها احتياجات معينة او حتى في المرحلة اللي احنا موجودين فيها اللي هي بتختلف عن باقي 400 قرية في فلسطين. يعني احنا بنشوف انه لو الدراسة هاي تمت بشكل سلمي وعلمي كانت ممكن تفيد كتير انه نطلع بالنتيجة اللي فيها انه نشتغل احنا كل واحد على مشروعه ويكون في سقف اللي يحتوي هاي المشاريع مع بعض ويلاقي الاشياء المشتركة فيها, مش يشوفها كتهديد لكيانه لانه فيها نوع من التطور عمليا في النضال. اهم نقطة بدي ارجع احكيها بالنسبة لهذا الموضوع هي انه ال 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 الكهلة اللي هي الكوميونيتي الرعي, انه احنا نضلنا نحافظ على حالنا كرعي. هذا اكبر انجاز احنا بنعمله. اذا بتيجوا يوم العيد بتشوفوا 400 شخص بيجي 500 شخص على كنيسة صغيرة, هذا بدل على ايش, وين احنا موجودين بالمقارنة مع الاخرين. فانا بدي انهي هون اذا في امكانية انه حدا بده يسأل سؤال بده يناقش
الأسئلة بعدين حاليا مداخلة.
شكرا لزخروت, شكرا على لك هذا المشروع, وشكرا لكم.
شكرا لك أخ نعمي. زخروت على فكرة كانت يعني شريكي مع جمعية إقريث, ونظمنا هناك أكثر من مرة جولات وزيارات وكتبنا كتيب عن تاريخ البلد. شار شكت شكرا. وإحنا طبعا بمناسبات عدة بننظم زيارات لإقريث, واللي حابب ينضم ويتعرف على القرية عن قرب ممكن يتابع إعلاناتنا وزياراتنا. ذكرت نعمي بس خطأ 400 قرية, العدد الرسمي للقرى الفلسطينية المهجرة المتبع بين المؤرخين هو 532 قرية, رغم انه في عندنا خريطه برا فيها كمان 600 اسم, يعني 600 قريه منذ بدايه التهجير قبل اقامه دوله اسرائيل. الملاحظه الاخيره ذكرت المقبره, وانه اهل إقريث للاسف يعودون الى بلدهم فقط امواتا. انه بهاي الساعه بالتحديد في جنازه اليوم في إقريث توفي عمها لشاد يسبيط, عضو في جمعيه اهالي إقريث, وقبل أيام توفي كمان عضو سابق في الجمعية دكتور إبراهيم رزق الله. فتعزينا إلكم والله يرحمهم. المتحدث التالي هو الدكتور أوري ديفيس. المداخلة تبعته راح تكون باللغة الإنجليزية, وراح كمان أقدمه باللغة الإنجليزية فحاولوا الترجمة. دكتور أوري ديفيس, the title is From the Palestinian Jamassin al-Gharbi to the Israeli Givat Amal Beit, or B, critical reading of the historical taboo. Dr. Davis is an anti-Zionist of European Jewish descent, born in Jerusalem in 1943, citizen of Apartheid Israel. Dr. Uri Davis is member of the Revolutionary Council of the Palestinian National Liberation Movement, Fatah, and member of the Palestine National Council, PNC, erstwhile associate professor at Al-Quds University Institute of Area Studies, IAS, Israel Studies Program, Jerusalem, Abu Dis, Palestine. Co-founder of the Exeter-based Palestine Studies Trust and University Fellow in the College of Social Sciences and International Studies, Institute of Arab and Islamic Studies, European Center of for Palestine Studies, University of Exeter, UK. Member of the Middle East Regional Committee of the International Journal Citizenship Studies, critical member of the Israeli and American Anthropological Associations, honorary member of the executive committees of the Calandia Camps Charitable Association and the Mental Health Families and Friends Society, Ramallah, Palestine, and chairperson of the now latent Al-Bayt Association for the Defense of Human Rights in Israel. Dr. Uri Davis, تفضل.
One advantage of not being among the first speakers is that one is privileged to comment on interventions of prior speakers, and some of the comments that were made I regard as relevant to my primary paper. So with the permission of the chairpersons, I will try and divide my time by half, more or less, and devote 10 minutes to outline my specific situation at this podium and to my paper. I was given a rather long introduction, and I want to focus on my membership in the Israeli Anthropological Association and American Anthropological Association, and on the word critical. I'm a student of the Department of Anthropology of the New School for Social Research, a student of the late Professor Stanley Diamond. The department is the forefront of critical anthropology, and what I have learned there has informed my professional and political work over decades. So I will start my situation here and now at this podium. We all know that 93% of the territory of the Israel proper is illegal land acquired by the political Zionist settler colonial invasion of Palestine, and in law, not just in practice, in law, is dedicated for Jewish settlement alone. And a Jewish should be put in quotes, because under the Israeli law of return, the definition of who is a Jew differs significantly from the Orthodox religious definition. 93% in law for Jews only. I am recently arrived from South Africa, where I was invited as one of the main speakers on Israel Apartheid Week in South Africa, and I can compare 87% of the territory of South Africa in the years and decades of apartheid were devoted in law for whites only, 13% for people defined in law as non-whites, 93% in Israel proper in law for Jews only, and about 7% for the apartheid divide between Jew and non-Jew. It's not in law between Jew and Arab, it's in law between Jew and non-Jew. So there isn't a square centimeter, with the exception of the 7%, of this country that doesn't stink under Zionist hegemony. And this place is no exception. But to my intuition, just as there are degrees in the Richter scale of earthquakes, there are degrees of stench. At the top of the so-called apartheid scale, I would point to the Israeli Knesset, the sovereign of apartheid Israel, and at the top of what I would call an apartheid stinking institution. And I wish in this connection to congratulate Zochrot, because they took a strategic decision similar to the strategic decision of the joint Arab list, where there is a crack, stick your foot in. And I subscribe to that decision. Where there is a crack, stick your foot in and say what you have to say until and if you're kicked out. But it still stinks. I have not as yet been invited to address audiences in the Knesset, but I have been invited to address audiences at this venue. And this venue, to my intuition, is grade number 9 of stench. This venue was directed by a criminal against humanity called Rehavam Ze'evi. This venue project as image as if the country of Palestine is the homeland of the occupier and not the homeland of the occupied, the homeland of the colonizer, not the homeland of the colonized. And I must admit that I deliberated quite a lot. What antidote can I bring to this podium in order to minimize the level of stench, at least insofar of my presentation? You know that I'm a member of the Palestine National Council, the representative of the Palestinian people worldwide, and a member of Fatah, so I brought an antidote, and I'm going to go behind the screen and put it on the podium, I hope, with your permission. The other comment I'm able to do, I have another 6 minutes. I am able to contribute in response to interventions made prior to mine is highlight the utility of international law and highlight the fact that we, and in this we, I include myself and my own organization and my own various institutions into which I have an input, we have underutilized this avenue, and that is international law. The values of political Zionism, the values of apartheid Israel are incompatible with the values of democratic constitutions, and addressing relevant international fora in liberal democratic states is bound almost, almost bound, or very likely to end up with a defeat of Zionist apology and Zionist position and Zionist legality. Now, the problem with international law, as I understand it, is that one has standing before international legal fora only if after exhausting all levels of domestic law. And I wish to address myself to the previous speakers and to other people who intervened. There are instances where the colonized people of Palestine, the Palestinian Arab people, have exhausted all domestic fora, including the High Court, and one of them is the case of Iqrit and Birim. In the case of Birim, I'm not sure that it applies also to Iqrit, until the last verdict, the Supreme Court justified Israeli government position or Israeli legal advisor position that the return of the refugees, internally displaced people, ethnically cleansed people of Birim and Iqrit is not possible for reasons of security. The last verdict that I'm aware of, and I stand to be corrected, and please correct me, is departure from false security allegations, which, well, you know, with great difficulty, international legal experts may accept, into straight political arguments. This is a precedent, and in the framework, temporal framework, where the government of the State of Israel is negotiating with the PLO a permanent settlement, a permanent status agreement. That precedent could somehow damage, dent, impinge, weaken Israeli position on the question of right of return of Palestine refugees. Now, take this to international fora. I would be very surprised if the people of Bir'im and Iqrit will not win flat down. And again, I'm perplexed that nothing was done in this direction, and maybe my comment and this conference would encourage people to address international law. They are not Mickey Mouse legal status. It is much easier to intimidate or bribe a politician. The frame of reference of a politician is the next elections. It is not that easier to intimidate or bribe an international justice. The frame of an international justice, or any justice for that matter, is the law. And of course, the Israeli Supreme Court, the law being an apartheid law, cannot diverge very much from the legislation of the Knesset. When structuring my paper, I decided to follow key questions put by the organizers of the conference to participants, suggesting that they may focus on these questions, and took as point of departure, thank you. Well, I didn't know that I was that good in timing myself. I'm primarily a university teacher, and university teachers tend to make long presentations and very detailed and footnoted. I took as point of departure the case of Givat Amal Bet and the ethnically cleansed people of Jamassin al-Gharbi, because as some of you may have had the occasion to follow, and I have images of the protest, where is justice? Harrison and Tshuva are liars, or Ramaim, but I can't think of the English term. And what other banners are there here? Mapai Natna Admot Medina Tzedek Chevrati Yachzir. Mapai, the ruling party at the time when the Arab Jews of Muslim and Arab countries were moved over to the lands of ethnically cleansed Jamassin al-Gharbi. Mapai, the ruling party, gave them state land, and social justice will return the lands to the people now removed from the territory of Jamassin al-Gharbi, Givat Amal Bet, and the territory has been handed to property developers. Now, of course, there is an elephant in the room, and that is the ethnically cleansed people of Jamassin al-Gharbi. They are now refugees in various refugee camps in the West Bank and beyond. But the people demanding justice of Givat Amal Bet fail to address their presence. And the question of return and the right of Palestine return is intimately related to a question that has been recurring as far as I could see. I'm sorry, I missed the first day. I returned the day before from South Africa and was not able to attend the previous day. But the question that is inherent to this subject is, what do you say to the Arab Jews who were pushed out of the area where they were placed by the government and are now having to seek alternative accommodation, either better or worse, but probably not Jabalia refugee camp or any other living conditions under which Palestinian 1948 refugees and their families have been reduced to reduce over the past sort of seven decades. Now again, I refer to international law, because of course, one common Zionist argument is that you do not correct an injustice by perpetrating another injustice. And international law addresses this question. For instance, the final report of the Special Rapporteur of the United Nations Organization, Paulo Sergio Pinheiro, submitted a report to the Commission of Human Rights and the Subcommission of the Promotion and Protection of Human Rights in the early 2000s. And I won't read even not the section that I quoted, save perhaps two sub-clauses. States should ensure that safeguard and due process extended to secondary occupants do not prejudice the rights of legitimate owners, tenants, and other rights, tenants and other right holders to repossess the housing, land, and property in question in a just and timely manner. States should, in cases where eviction of secondary occupants, that the Arab Jews of Givat Amal Bet, are justifiable and unavoidable, the states should, in cases where eviction of secondary occupants are evictions are justifiable and unavoidable, take positive measures to protect those who do not have means to access any other adequate housing other than that which they are currently occupying, protect them from homelessness and other violations of their right to adequate housing. So appeal to, for instance, the Special Rapporteur's final report could provide a measure of defense and support to secondary inhabitants, including many of us who have properties in Tel Aviv or in one of the new towers like the U Towers and related towers on the land of Jamassin al-Gharbi. So that is my point of departure. The question that follows is the implication of return for Zionist ideology and practice. The implication of return, to my reading, for Zionist ideology and practice is the collapse of apartheid Israel, similar to the collapse of apartheid South Africa, and here international BDS, boycott, divestment, and sanctions, has a hugely important role to play, peaceful and focused, and I believe again will contribute to a similar consequence in Palestine as the anti-apartheid over decades. It takes decades to do, not months and not years, decades, brought down apartheid South Africa. Another question that I chose to address is how return will occur in practice and how it can offer an opportunity of living together in a truly democratic, egalitarian, and just regime for all inhabitants of the country, and how will it, how will a joint space look like in terms of nationality, and how will identities be shaped by return? My paper is available in hard copy to the, actually in color printed hard copy, so you can have a good glimpse of the images, and a copy of which will go to the organizer, and a PDF file which they may or may not choose to circulate. So I'll just focus on the core of, or nutshell of, my answer. The nutshell of my answer is that no imagination, proper imagination, in respect of implementation of an answer to this question can take place prior to defeat of settler colonial Zionism, prior to the defeat of apartheid Israel. It is only after the defeat of political Zionism in Palestine and with the nullification of Israeli apartheid legislation and its replacement with a democratic constitution guarantee equality of individual and collective rights to all, the implementation of the right of return of all 1948 families and descendants, Laji'in and Nazihin and Muhajirin, to return and possession of the right to the titles to their property. And I emphasize titles because in most cases the homes and the farms have been leveled ground, but the land is there and the titles are there. And the titles are not held by the settler colonial invaders. The titles are held by the Jewish National Fund, about 15%, and by the state, another 75%, more or less. Don't catch me by the percentage, please. And the transfer of title is an easy computer transaction and taboo transaction. Thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of Palestinian families have their taboo papers, but they won't be transferred to the legal owners unless the regime collapses, or to be very more specific, unless the core of Israeli apartheid is removed. And the core are the Zionist legislation, the Knesset legislation on the status of the World Zionist Organization, the Knesset legislation on the status of the Jewish National Fund, the Knesset legislation on the status of the Jewish Agency. All this has to be removed. The covenant between the Jewish National Fund and the state in respect of veiling Israeli apartheid by the afforestation and the recreational project, all that has to be removed, in which case the titles could be returned to all title holders. And what will happen to the present inhabitants? My personal suggestion, I'm not speaking for the Palestine National Council, I'm not speaking for the Fatah or the PLO, I'm a peace center. If the current settler families become tenants and pay rent until their 49-year contract leasehold expires, well, I would consider that a humanitarian first step rather than replacing injustice with injustice.
Okay. Yep.
As to identities, again, my presentation. 1 minute? Two
yes,
minutes?
Please.
1 minute. Well, I'll go through half of my paper. My presentation suggests one Palestine state, federal, in respecting international legitimacy, all UN resolution, all. One, not only 194, right of return, but also 181, partition of Palestine into three segments. But that also means that Jerusalem is not the capital of Israel, and the borders are not the armistice lines, but the 1947 borders. But the constitution is one and Palestinian, the citizenship is one and Palestinian, the currency is one and Palestinian, sovereignty is one and Palestinian, property, one and Palestinian, and there are three language groups. A family where the family at home is Arabic is the Arabic language group, the family where the language at home is Hebrew, it's a Hebrew language group, and there is an official English language group corresponding to the fact that the city of Jerusalem is under UN administration. And with this, I believe my time is up. Mm-hmm. And you'll have to read the rest. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Shukran.
Speakers would choose to keep this flag. If not, I donate it to Zochrot. Thanks.
Thank you. The third speaker, Dr. Selma Porobić. Dr. Porobić holds a double MD and PhD degree in migration studies from Lund University, Sweden, focused on forced migration, and is a founding director of UNHCR, initiated Center for Refugee and IDP Studies at the Faculty of Political Sciences, University of Sarajevo in Bosnia and Herzegovina. She is currently project coordinator for the regional RRPP, Freiburg University funded 2-year-long project employing 21 researchers on investigating the psychological, right? Sociosocial, actually, yeah, yes. Services for female forced migrants, and that's enough. Thank you very much.
Days, the watch is there.
You don't want to donate that for Zochrot.
Oh, okay.
نطلع.
Hello again. Some of you have met me yesterday, so I said to Omar to skip the whole introduction, who I am. But I received a lot of questions since yesterday when I presented how rights-based return actually was realized for Bosnians and the true property repossession that went well, 99% of property that was confiscated, occupied during the war, when 60% of Bosnians were expelled, did go back to its rightful owners in this process of 10 years and now 20 years of peace implementation in Bosnia. So the questions I received were very much in direction, how is this, you know, how can your experience now, and I talked about post-return realities yesterday, how can it be of use to our situation here? Because we are only in the at the level of conceptualizing return, thinking, imagining return. And I said, I was thinking through this very much yesterday. It is a different position that I come from and I talk about. It is a post-return reality. But if there is a message and in what I shared with you from the experiences of returnees, yesterday in the three communities with successful return, although the context, as I told you, despite the property repossession, is rather negative. It's just the numbers of 1 million return tell us only about property repossession, not the actual return. It's much lesser. And even today, I will talk about the post-return, but I will go back and talk about the actual process of return to the lens, through the perspective of women. The ultimate message would be, and I was thinking about this yesterday, that despite the different positions, you know, post-return reality that I'm sharing from the returnees' perspective through the research, and the current reality of where the return, rights-based return, is just, it's being conceptualized, it's being just in a, you know, in at the level of thinking about it and strategizing and how to implement it, is that it doesn't end with return. I'm sorry to say that, because from the position where we conceptualize, strategize, and think about it, we tend to think once the return occurs, and we enable it to rights-based argument, and even write it in a peace treaty, like the case of Bosnia, and then at the level of state, make a strategy and implementation policies and everything. It doesn't end there. You return, but the struggle goes on to remain in the places where you return, especially in the positions where your return is not welcomed, as is the case in Bosnia. You become a minority in the places where you return. So the struggle to actually fight the structural discrimination goes on for returnees from the moment when they return. I mean, all the way through, fighting for return, actually going through the return process, and being a returnee up to today, I'm talking about 20 years in Bosnia's case, is a struggle, and it continues. So I will talk about specific struggle of a woman. Something happened with my computer, yeah. And one woman who can serve as a symbol of a women's perspective to realizing the return in Bosnia. The name of the woman is M. Sudat Mujagic, and there's a lot written about Emsa, it's a short name, nickname for her. Because she was among the women, she comes from a small village, Kozarac, and this is not about that village, actually. It's about the women and the women from that village who connected to other women, displaced women, across the globe, and actually and started fighting for peace immediately in the refugee camps in the neighboring countries, and she was placed in one of the camps in Croatia. This is 92 to 93. After the whole village was expelled, a lot of people put in concentration camps. Those notorious concentration camps that you heard about were in that location, Manjača, and all the other ones that you can read a lot about this little village, Kozarac, which also became a symbol for return in itself, because it is a positive, again, a positive example in a very negative, generally negative context of return, sustainable return to Bosnia. So I will tell you the story And it will be less academic, because I think it doesn't need to be so academic. If you want, you can read a lot about the woman, about the village, many PhDs and books written about this, especially, you know, from the perspective of transitional justice, because this is where these returnees are right now. They're fighting their way to access their basic human rights and socioeconomic rights, like right to work, right to educate their children, etc. It's not at all that you return and all is flowers and working. It's just it only starts there, the way into the society and becoming a citizen that is can access all these rights as all others, in the case of minority returns, of course. So I'm going to read a couple of things from the camp from 93, actually, from her diary. But before that, and the things that I'm going to read about are how they started thinking about being peace activists actually is a key to return. So, but before that, in one of the interviews with her, she said like this: "It is a woman on all sides who lose the most in war. Rights for which women have fought and won during time of peace disappear in a war. Your daughters, your property, your freedom, and even your own body can be taken during war by men with guns. It's very different how men perceive of peace and war. They oftentimes, I think, identify with themselves," she said. "When you identify only with yourself, the suffering of others is meaningless. Women's identity, however, is usually with their family and their community. When you identify with others, you can easily understand the pain caused to others through war or domination." She started thinking about and organizing in the refugee camp with other women, Croatian women, who were expelled from their own homes. They came together and they contacted women across the world and initiated an organization that is called Through Heart to Peace. This organization became crucial throughout the peace, throughout the return process that started in the camp and spread throughout the camps, refugee camps, Bosnian refugee camps, but also Croatian refugee camps in Croatia in the 90s. And then she took the organization with her, together with other women, when they actually started realizing the return just after the peace agreement was signed by often visiting Bosnia. This is how it started. They would go on a first visit, and this was very hard. They couldn't find anyone to support, not even the International Police Task Force that was there in place to help returnees after the peace agreement was reached, and the special Annex 7 that I talked about yesterday that actually guaranteed the right to return to returnee to this place. It wasn't easy, because not even International Police Task Force would support in that early phase visits and going back home, because it was unsafe. And indeed, the first visits to her hometown were met by women and children there stoning the bus that they came in for a visit. And a lot of returnees in the early years were actually also, as I said yesterday, shot at. So it was not really, even though the whole legal apparatus was in place and international bodies and in police to protect returnees, it wasn't easy to start returning. So the first thing they did, they managed to get into Bosnia from Croatia. They planted a tree. I have pictures of this, and I promised to Zochrot colleagues that I will make a folder with the pictures, because I didn't have time to do that before this presentation. They planted a tree as a symbol for peace, and then they went back. That was the first thing they did. Later on, this is how she said what they started doing in the refugee camp, a concrete things that also follow them all the way through when they returned to Bosnia. And upon return, of course, they became IDPs first, because they could not immediately return to their own village. So, but she said like this, this is 96 when she was interviewed, remembering the time in the camp and how they were preparing for return. She said, "We were working to prepare people psychologically for return. We held trauma counseling sessions and conflict resolution seminars twice monthly for 50 or so women. The purpose of this session was to confront reality. When people return home, there are hard questions. How will I live? I think this will be the hardest confrontation with reality. The truth is very difficult. There is still a large element of this experience that does not feel real. People, in a sense, think they are still dreaming. But then, when they finally return to Kozarac, they will really understand what happened to them, that their sons and husbands are not alive, that they will not reappear. We are preparing for economic projects to facilitate our return to Kozarac as well. We hope to continue in Kozarac what we have done here in the refugee camps. One program we are preparing is a mobile kitchen to help people eat in Kozarac. There are workmen who are restoring damaged homes, and they will buy food from us. Some of our people will be able to earn some money this way. Also, the kitchens will help the women who are working all day cleaning rubble from their houses. Maybe they don't even have a kitchen. These are women who still live in displaced area or nearby, and they come back to Kozarac by day to clean their homes and prepare their gardens. And then she goes on and on and on how they initiated activities in the refugee camp and activities which were economic, psychological, in any sense, to prepare the return, to prepare the people for return. So when they actually returned, and this was 97, they were not able to return to their home village, but they returned to the nearby town Sanski Most, which is about 20 kilometers from their hometown, from the village. And there they were displaced persons, of course. So they addressed different set of questions as displaced persons, different from those that they were addressing in a refugee camp. I remember she was telling me on a number of occasions when I had interviews with her as well, the first thing actually that they fought for, how it all started in the refugee camp, was that they fought for their dignity as women. The occasion that she always remembers that felt very hard to them was not really the missing members of a family. She lost 48 members of a family herself only. And not being, you know, all the losses that she endured. It was actually the humanitarian aid. When they got clothes from women colleagues from the West who wanted to help in this way in the camp, and they got clothes, you know, like old clothes that, and when the women opened the packages, they felt completely shocked because it was another kind of degrading treatment from those that they expected understanding from. Understanding never came. So, but they were depressed, she said, and this is just a small story among many stories. But then they realized that, okay, we need to work on having them understand us. And no one can do it for us but ourselves. So they tore apart all the clothes and recreated the clothes that they would wear. And then they invited UNHCR and different international organizations, and then they made a fashion week with different refugee women wearing the clothes as they would wear them. And so they produced even a catalog saying, I don't know, Amina from this village wearing something that she got from England, but this is how she would wear it. And from that was to show that, you know, if you can take everything away from us, but not really dignity, that was their way of showing it. So ever since then, they never received clothes anymore in the camp, but the piles of textiles, so they could create whatever they needed for themselves, for children, for others. And she takes that story as because it was the first experience of when they started thinking how they could go about resolving things or taking things into their own hands. Upon return, and I'm just, it's a very long story, and I'm taking it, you know, I'm trying to make a short story out of it. Being an IDP was another moment, so the whole process of return in practice was a gradual process. So from the aspect of IDPs, they worked slowly on going and visiting more often the home village that they wanted to return to, and also for the burials, because there would be excavations and mass graves, and they would find the missing persons, and then the missing persons would be buried in the village. So there was a return of dead people, the relatives, and they were buried in the village. So They needed a religious person for, it was for the religious ceremony of burials, and they trained men to become imams, IDPs, in order to have imams bearing and being present at the ceremony. Women were behind it because it would be very sensitive in any way to have men or male displaced and refugees going back to the village so early on. So what the next thing that they were doing was organizing a conferences, peace conferences, which already started in a refugee camp, but they wanted to move the peace conference, building a peace, you know, peace through heart. That was their idea. What you are seeing is also the website of the organization, Through Heart to Peace, with some pictures of the destroyed village and later on also how they rebuilt it and worked. And there is a whole gallery of these pictures, activities that they've done. I'm just mentioning few. The conference on peace was then implemented in nearby town where they were displaced. And they invited a lot of people from their own village and youth, young children, to participate, regardless of ethnicity. That was their main goal, to start talking about peace and building a peace together. Then they slowly moved back, and they did return eventually, few of them, first women with this organization. It was 97. And the first thing they did was also not just to rebuild, you know, to work on rebuilding the houses, which was a long process, it took a while, but was also to continue with these peace conferences, to bring the peace. They brought, they created the venues where everyone would gather and discuss how peace is important for the rebuilding of the community and the whole society in itself. These conferences continued. The last one was 2014, as far as I remember. Now it's visited by, you know, the people from all over the world. A number of activities were initiated through this women organization, also helped organize in other women NGOs in Bosnia, around 20 in different towns, but also male NGOs in a way, or mutual, but also, I mean, when I say male, organizing the civilian victims of war, men, which was very hard to think about in immediate post-war period. But these women, because they were perceived as less of a threat, let's speak so, and they could use what is called a crypto-matriarchic space of power, by some colleagues, to be a bit academic and boring. So they used the space, you know, which was, because they were not perceived as a threat, a power threat, in the returnee village by those who had the power, which were men mainly, to actually found a number of important NGOs which addressed all possible issues in community that you can think about, and also helped rebuild the local school, equip the school. The projects of youth gathering are there, different kind of events that bring young people together through sports, through culture. So, you know, the list is very long, and they continue to work on this because, the biggest stress, the biggest accent in their work today is on civilian victims of war, actually, and on building the community together transethnically. The work never stops, the work never ends. And that is the message of the village, actually, and the women. Why I took a perspective of women, because in many ways, as I said, they were not perceived as a threat. If the activities that they've initiated were initiated by men in the immediate post-war period, I don't think they would have succeeded as much as these women have succeeded in restoring the whole community, because they were not perceived as a threat. The whole process of return was enabled through the peace treaty and through a government, strategy for implementation of the special annex of the peace treaty, which was entirely dedicated to displaced. But it would not have happened if there wasn't for a bottom-up process of these people, especially. And I wanted to enhance the perspective of women playing an important role. If they did not take it into their own hands. This morning when I was listening, just to round up, Mr. Suleiman when he said we will return and we will, if it takes, if that is what it takes, we will build a tents on our in our villages, you know, to make our presence. That is exactly how the return process in reality happened, because despite the legal backup of the rights-based return and all the international organization being there in place to help, it did not start happening before the returnees themselves went to their villages, or it's usually villages, and it's a bit different how it went on in the urban areas. It's a different story, actually, and build the tents. Next to their war-destroyed property or occupied property, and put on these tents the big signs, we want to see this Annex 7 in practice. So they actually showed the way to all the actors that there were, both international community, UN, NGOs, international ones, local ones, that just popped up as mushrooms, that kind of advocated the right for return and wanted to facilitate return. It wasn't really before the returnees themselves showed the way, this is how you, how we want to do it, that that it become became reality. Okay, I will stop there.
Can you see,
thank
how,
you very
how
much.
How long time they stayed in the tents before building up?
Sorry?
How long time they stayed in the tents before they built up? The
months, couple months. Of months. It's different, but I know examples of returnees to Srebrenica, the first returnee tent settlements, as they call them, 4 to 5 months on average.
Thank you very much. Very interesting. Thank you. Okay, we still have 15 minutes for questions. معنا 15 دقيقة للأسئلة والملاحظات. إذا في أسئلة بين الجمهور تفضلوا. حاليا الأستاذ نعمة إذا ممكن تضيف بس شوية توضيح للتخطيط اللي عملتوه في إقرث ومصيره، وذكرت هناك إنه يعني كنا نتوقع نهاية تختلف عن النهاية اللي وصلناها، يعني شو اللي صار هناك؟
في الواقع التخطيط كان مبادرة مننا لمحاولة من المحاولات العديدة اللي إحنا منقوم فيها لحك السلطة على تنفيذ عمليا التوصيات اللجنة الوزارية. كيف احنا شفناها؟ المشروع مع اللجنة الوزارية انقطع بدون التخطيط هذا، بدون تكملة، فاحنا اجينا وكملناه من طرفنا تيكون موضوع للمفاوضات مع المسؤولين إذا كان في الحكومة أو في سلطات التنظيم اللوائية. فزي ما عملنا بالكهرباء، كان الهدف من هذا الإشي إنه إحنا نقدمه بالآخر لسلطات التخطيط، طبعا خرائط المطلوبة لبناء بلد، والمحل اللي بدنا اللي كنا بدنا نواجه فيه مشكلة كان بده يكون ساعتها موضوع لدعوة. هاي استشارة عمليا احنا اخذناها من حقوقيين بارزين في هذا المجال من البلاد ومن برية البلاد، اللي عمليا احنا من مارسة على نار هادي يعني بعدة مجالات وبعدة نشاطات. فالهدف كان من هذا التخطيط انه يكون كمان نوع من دراسة للكونسبت. يعني اجينا احنا بفكرة، الفكرة هي فكرة جديدة، وفكرنا انه العناوين المناسبة لدراسة هذا المشروع هو يكون مع لجنة المهجرين ومع لجان حقوق الانسان اللي عمليا بتدعم مشاريع العودة او مشروع العودة للقرى المهجرة في الداخل. فللأسف كانت تجربة ببدايتها كتير ناجحة، بس بعدين تغيرت أشخاص في مواقع معينة اللي أخذوا مواقف اللي ما كانت واضحة لنا. طلبنا منهم إنه يكتونا أشياء بمكتوبة، يعني طب وين الخطأ؟ ليش إحنا مثلا ما منعرفش شو النقطة اللي إحنا مثلا فيها
انتوا بتشوفوش انه احنا فيها جزء من الاجماع زي ما هن فسروه. وهيك فكت الشراكة، والصندوق الدعم كمان اللي كان داعم المشروع اخذ موقف من هذا الاشي، انه هذا مشروع ممكن يكون مشكلة بدون اي تفسير بدون اي توضيح بشكل رسمي. فبقي التخطيط لنا يعني احنا بنشوفه كخطة اللي لازم تكون عنا. انا بتذكر بالمفاوضات اللي كانت مع الحكومة بسنة الـ94 والـ95 كان عنا وضعية مثلا انه احنا ما فهمناش ايش يشوف كهلتي لما عرضوا علينا ايش هاي اللي يشوف كهلتي. فقلنا احنا انه بمرحلة من المراحل لازم يكون عنا احنا حاضرين لأي حل او لأي طرح اللي يكون في عندنا تصور ودراسة مسبقة، مش وإحنا قاعدين في الجلسة نبدأ نتناقش هل هذا مناسب ولا مش مناسب. فكانت عملية دراسة يعني لتصور معين.
أوكي. في كمان أسئلة بين الجمهور. أوكي عظيم، ممكن نخلص قبل الوقت يعني. أوكي شكرا لكم. Thank you. نأخذ استراحة الجلسة القادمة على الساعة 4:30. شكرا لكم، إلى اللقاء.